Thank you very much for inviting me, and thank you for joining the talk. Let X be a geometrically irreducible hypersurface of degree D over FQ. Geometrically irreducible means that it stays irreducible over the algebraic closure. For us, Q will be large relative to D. We'll be interested in the regime when Q is large. Think about Q as greater than D to the fourth. The results will be most meaningful when Q is D to the fourth or more. And our goal is to study the number of FQ rational points on X. If X is given by the data of a polynomial with coefficients in FQ of degree D, we are counting the number of FQ solutions of the corresponding polynomial equations. The foundational result is the Lang-Weyl bound, which says that this quantity capital N is approximately Q to the N minus one with error given in this way, where CD depends only on D. I suppress the dependence on N, a priori also on N, but CD does not depend on Q and definitely not on X. Our goal, more specifically, will be to study the dependence of CD on D. Now, in the case of curves, when X is a curve, N is equal to 2, the foundational result is due to Weyl for singular curves and Aubry-Perret for possibly Weyl for non-singular and Aubry-Perret for possibly singular curves. The bound is as follows. You can see that CD can be taken to be D minus 1 for the lower bound and 1 for the upper bound. The D that shows up in the lower bound is an artifact that I've stated it in affine space. Next, I will summarize what is known about explicit Lang-Weyl bounds in the higher dimensional case when N is greater than 2. I will not do the entire literature review, but only the most relevant results. Namely, Gorpa de la Shaw proved that CD can be taken to be polynomial in D. They are the first to establish a polynomial bound. Prior bounds had been really bad, namely exponential in D. I should say Gorpa de la Shaw accomplished a lot more in their paper. They use Eladic cohomology techniques, and this is just one of the outcomes of their work. They give this polynomial bound. Next, Kafur and Matera give a bound of degree which does not grow with n, using more elementary tools. Namely, you can put 5d to the 13 over 3. And if Q is large, if Q is greater than 15d to the 13 over 3. Now think of this 13 over 3 as just a little bit more than 4. I said that we are concerned with the range Q greater than d to the fourth. That's when Lang-Weyl makes most sense. And then for that range, you can make it quadratic in D. This is their result. And what I managed to do for the lower bound, again, for large Q, Q greater than D to the 13 over 3, I can make it linear in D, as it is in the case of curves. In the case of plane curves, remember in the Weyl and Aubry-Perret theorem, you can take CD to be linear in D. This is for the lower bound. And for the upper bound, I can actually make CD not depend on D altogether. I can just put a 5. Now, of course, at this stage, you ask about the best example. How close are these bounds to being tight? Now, how can we construct an example? One way is to take a curve with very few or with many FQ rational points, and then the equation that defines the curve, look at it as an equation just in n variables. So you multiply the FQ count by Q to the n minus 2. In this way, we can construct examples. I would call this cylinder over a curve. You cross the curve with affine space. For the lower bound, you can achieve what is on the top line. And for the upper bound, you can achieve easily, you can achieve what is on the bottom line. So these you can achieve. Now, there is a gap between the example and the theorem. We would be interested in closing this gap. We can ask for better examples. Can you give examples which are better? Some hypersurface not coming from a curve, which has fewer points than what we have on the top line, or a hypersurface with more points than what we had on the bottom line. Now, just a little warning, we can choose here C to be non-singular. So in this example, we can find the non-singular hypersurface, but its projective closure will be very singular. The singular locus will have very large dimension, dimension n minus 2 or dimension n minus 1. So if you're looking for a threefold, for example, its projective closure would need to have singular locus of dimension at least 1 or 2. So you have to look at singular stuff. This follows from a theorem by Gorpa de la Shaw from this paper that I cited. So this is about the examples. If you have an example that is doing better, I would be very interested and a little bit surprised. To be honest, sometimes, to tell you the truth, sometimes I think that optimal examples would come from curves in this way. Now, the other way to close the gap between the example and the theorem is to improve a little bit more the theorem. Now, the 0.6 looks kind of random, and the 5 is actually also looking kind of random. The 0.6 we can replace by 0.001, or in fact, I can remove it altogether. I can remove this 0.6 altogether, and I can state an asymptotic version of the lower bound. If I remove the 0.6, I can state the following version. I just put a minus d, and the rest of the dependence of d is pushed further down the line. I can make a statement like that. So this is an asymptotic version. And for the upper bound, this 5, I can make, I can replace the 5 by smaller quantities. I can put 1 plus pi square over 6, which is like 2.65. Now, if you compare the examples with the bounds in the theorem, they're very close. And qualitatively, what I'm saying is that if you try to find a hypersurface with a very small or a very large number of FQ points, you will not do much better than what you would have just coming from curves, regardless of how large your degree is, regardless of how large D is, you will be very, very, very close to the counts that you can achieve by a curve. Now, I will present the proof. It will be actually rather short. It is based on the following purely combinatorial lemma. It's a version of the random sampling lemma on Terital's block. Let S be a subset of FQ to the N, just a subset. There is no algebraic geometry in this lemma. It's pure combinatorics. For a plane H chosen uniformly at random, consider the number of points in the intersection of S and H as a random variable. So we slice X with every single plane and look at the statistics. Then you can calculate the mean, and we can calculate the variance. To calculate the mean, very easy. All we have to do is for each point of S, count the proportion of planes passing through that point. Very easy, we calculate the mean in this way. To calculate the variance, all we have to do is it boils down to computing the second moment. To compute the second moment, for any two distinct points of S, we have to count the number of planes passing through these two points. And that number is independent of which two points of S we pick. And therefore, actually, mu and the variance sigma square, they do not depend on S very much. They only depend on the cardinality of S. Now, let's look at an example in our case of interest. So just not in our case of interest, let's say S has Q to the N minus one elements. Our S will be the set of FQ points on a hypersurface. It will have roughly Q to the N minus one elements. So let's say it has exactly Q to the N minus one elements. Then the mean will be Q. And sigma square will be less than or equal to Q. This is what we read from the equations when S has Q to the N minus one elements. How excited should we get about these bounds? How excited should we get? Well, a priori, sigma square is the expected value of the square of the random variable minus mu square. So in the case when mu is equal to q, sigma square is a difference of two terms, each of which will be q square. So it's a difference of two terms that are like q square. However, after the cancellation, sigma square ends up just less than or equal to q. So there is an entire factor of q that we gain from this bound on the variance. A priori, the naive bound would be sigma square, but the actual bound is q, and this will be a big deal. Now, from this, with this in mind, we revisit our geometrically reducible hypersurface of degree d over fq. Remember that q is large. And let's discuss the upper bound on n, the number of FQ points on x. So I will now discuss the upper bound. Surely, we slice x with a random plane and count the number of FQ points. So for h, chosen uniformly at random among all planes over FQ. By the way, when I say planes, I mean two-dimensional. Planes are two-dimensional here, not necessarily passing through the origin. So we hit with planes and count the number of FQ points on the intersection. The largest possibility is Q square. If the plane is contained in the hypersurface, you get Q square. And now the values, for geometric reasons, the values cannot be just anywhere on this line segment. The values, you cannot see values all over the place, because unless x is contained in h, then you can look at x intersect h. It will be a curve of degree d in h. So it will be a plane curve of degree d. And it will have, you can decompose it into FQ reducible components. Some of them will be geometrically reducible. Each such will contribute roughly Q points by the Vail bound, Vail and Toubry-Perret bound. Intersections will contribute very little, and FQ components that are not geometrically reducible, they also contribute very little. So if it has K geometrically reducible components, then the number of points is roughly K times Q. So the possible values for this random variable, they're very restricted. They have to be near integer multiples of Q until D times Q, or Q square is also allowed. So they're very, very restricted. Remember, Q is large. These intervals, they have radius big O of square root of Q. Now, because I will be doing the upper bound, it's convenient just to save notation to combine the intervals containing zero and Q into one interval. And let me give names to the intervals, I1 until ID, and then also I infinity. Now let's apply the random sampling lemma. This was, so far, this was geometry of X intersect H. We haven't even used geometric irreducibility of capital X so far. Now we apply the random sampling lemma. The mean is the total number of points over Q to the N minus two. The mean is easy to calculate. And by a very weak version of Lang-Vail. For Lang-Vail, let's use only that capital N is Q to the N minus one plus big O. I don't even care about any more details about the error, big O of Q to the N minus three halves. And therefore the mean will be approximately equal to Q. It is Q plus error big O of square root of Q. The mean is approximately equal to Q. So by the random sampling lemma, the values, they must be concentrated near the mean. They must be in I1. They must fall in I1 mostly. Some of them could be in I2, some of them could be in IK, maybe all the way until ID or I infinity, but there will be fewer and fewer values far away from the mean because the variance is so small. Now, let's make this quantitative. I need to introduce BK to be the right endpoint of the interval IK. And now to bound the mean, we now have to give an upper bound for capital N, or equivalently for the mean. To give an upper bound for the mean, we estimate as follows. Any time if H is such that the random variable has value in the interval IK, then the contribution from that H is some number in IK, which is at most BK. So we bound it by the probability that you fall in IK times BK, which is an upper bound for any intersection, for any number of FQ points on the intersection that falls in IK. So we bound the probability like this. And now here, as K grows, unfortunately, planes H for which the random variable has value in IK, they do contribute a lot towards the mean, because anytime you're in IK, you have a contribution of roughly K times Q. There is no escape. However, the beta k will decrease. In a moment, we'll give an upper bound on the beta k. So there is a race as k grows. There is a race between the contribution for planes, the contribution from planes, so that the random variable falls in ik or beyond. So the contribution is large, but the probability that this takes place decreases. Who wins the race and by how much? So look here, if k is at least two, there will be a gap anytime the random variable falls in ik or to the right. There is a gap from the mean, and the gap will be k minus one times q, roughly. So this, the gap is k minus 1 times square root of q times the standard deviation. And by Chebyshev's inequality, the probability that the value of the random variable is in ik or to the right is bounded like this, 1 over k minus 1 squared times q. This is a bound not just on beta k, but on the beta k plus all the way until beta d and plus beta infinity. This is the bound that the, for the probability that the random variable falls in ik or to the right. Very, very small, very, very small. And now when we look at this summation, we look at this summation and the dominant term in the summation will be when k is equal to 1, because for beta 1, this whole argument is saying that beta 1 is the dominant term. So we cannot give any bound on beta 1. We cannot say anything non-trivial on beta 1 or on, so B1, the term where beta 1, we can only bound by 1, by the trivial bound. So B1, we definitely have a B1. Now, this sum, we estimate by using Abel summation, because we have the partial, we have bounds on the partial sums of the beta. And what about the consecutive differences of the Bs? These green intervals, they're translates of each other by Q. They just go Q units to the right each time. So the Bs, they, any two consecutive Bs, they differ by Q. In terms of this race that I was talking about, the Bs, they don't grow fast enough. They only grow in an arithmetic progression, and the probabilities, they decrease really fast. So when we do Abel summation, well, the first term will be bounded by B1, and then partial sum of the betas, multiply this by Q. So if you multiply the bound in the red inequality by Q, we just get the inverse squares. This is from Abel summation, and everything is up to an error. I've been suppressing the error terms on this slide to make it nicer to see. And then B1, for B1, we have no choice. For B1, we use the bound from Weyl's theorem and Aubry-Perret. So B1 is bounded like that. B1 is bounded. This is the case for curves. And we see where the pi square over 6 comes from. And then we have an error term. And that's the end of the proof, because if you multiply by q to the n minus 2, we see that capital N is at most q to the n minus 1. Then you have d minus 1, d minus 2, q to the n minus 3 halves. And then the coefficient of q to the n minus 2, remember in my asymptotic theorem, it was 1 plus pi square over 6. And now you can see the 1 plus pi square over 6. But things become actually nicer when you have divided by q to the n minus 2. So look, what are the ingredients? We did use geometry of X intersect H, that it has a certain number of FQ components that are geometrically reducible. So we have the green intervals. Then we used the combinatorial lemma, and we used that X is geometrically reducible. So capital N is approximately Q to the N minus 1. So the mean is approximately Q. These were the ingredients. And then with Abel summation, we finish the proof. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this nice talk. And are there questions or comments? We have 5 minutes for that. Yes, there is a question by Christoph.
Yeah, thanks. I was just wondering, I mean, for the lower bound, I mean, it's not at all the same kind of ideas, or can you also use the same tricks?
Oh, yes, 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 yes. For the lower bound, yes, yes. I discussed the upper bound, but for the lower bound, you have to use the intervals here. Here, for the lower bound, the mean is again next to Q. Here, for the very first interval, actually, if you have no geometrically reducible components, then the number of FQ points is bounded by d squared divided by 4, by d squared over 4. So you will have, you then bound the number of planes for which the random variable falls in the leftmost interval. the distance between any point in the leftmost interval and the green interval near Q is large enough. And you use the same works for the lower bound. I just presented the upper bound because it's more fun to see the pi square over 6 and the Abel summation. You don't have the Abel summation in the lower bound.
I see. And does this interpretation, as you do like on the line with the intervals, lead you to try to find what would be the shape of like a record? What would be close to the upper bound or the lower bound?
Close to the upper bound, yes. To be close to the upper bound, you need to have a lot of values concentrated near Q. So you should have fewer and fewer values. And that's why these cylinders, they have the property that many slices are actually maximal curves. You need to have many slices that are maximal curves or curves with very few FQ points in order to be close in the end to the extreme values. That's why sometimes I think that the optimal examples will come from curves. But actually the mean is not just less than the sigma square. It's not just less than or equal to Q. It's actually very close to Q. So there is some deviation there.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
There is another question by Sudhir.
Yeah, thank you, Kaulo, for this nice
thank
talk.
You, thank you.
So do you also have similar things for projective hypersurfaces?
Yes, we can state it for projective. The whole proof works. So for the projective case, I will not have this D in the lower bound. I will not have the D in the lower bound. It the same proof just works. I stated it for the affine case. Sure. But the proof also works.
Sure. Thank you.
Yes, that's true.
Are there any other questions or remarks? If not, let's thank our speaker again. And I'll see you in 6 minutes from now for our last talk of this morning. Mm-hmm.